Let us pause for a time of prayer. O God, as we hear these words, as we reflect on them together, as we enter into your presence with joy and thanksgiving, help us, O God, just to relax in your presence. Take from us the tension that makes peace impossible. Take from us the fears that do not allow us to venture. Take from us the worries that blind our sight. Take from us the distress that hides your joy. Help us to know that we are with you. We are in your care. We are in your love. And that you and all of us are one. And through the power of the Holy Spirit, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of all of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, you who are our rock and our redeemer. Amen. So a few weeks ago, as I was going through some boxes, you all know what it's like when you go through old boxes and you start doing this little archaeological dig on your own personal history, I came upon a painting. The painting was entitled The Parade. It was quite an interesting painting, full of primary colors. It looked like it was painted on primary color day. A lot of bold blues and reds and yellows and all sorts of things. So this is a painting of a parade. And it was a painting that I did when I was maybe 8 or 9 years old. Dare I say it was about 50 years old. But I was fascinated by this painting of the parade. First of all, it was big. And you all know I am not an artist. This was my first and last attempt at being an artist. If you'd like to take a look, here it is. But we can look at it. My first and last attempt. But it was big, and it was bold. And I have to say, it had a lot of energy. There were these marching band figures. And there were people on the sidelines, spectators. And interestingly, two planes in the air, if you grow up near LaGuardia Airport, I guess that's what you're going to put on, a little close to each other. The FAA would not have approved of this. But interesting, both the planes and the marching band and the spectators, they were all going in the same direction. It was fascinating. I don't really know what I had in mind, because you don't see a lot of parades in New York, but there it was. But what really fascinates me the most, and I'm not inviting any psychological analysis here, so you can hold that, please. All the faces are blank. There are no features. Even though there's a lot of energy and movement, there's no emotion. It was a parade that almost looks like it's by rote, just doing it, nothing coming forward with passion, with motivation, with real belief in what they were doing in this parade. But it is a bit impressive nonetheless. Well, today we heard a story about another parade. Now, this parade isn't quite like the July 4th parade, right, that we do here in Orleans. And a little bit of a plug, it would be wonderful if we have a float this year. So if anybody feels so moved, today on Palm Sunday, say, yes, I'm going to work on the Federated Church plug for the July 4th parade. Please do let me know. But it's about a parade. Jesus taking those steps towards the gate of Jerusalem. There are no faces on this painting that I did. The faces are blank. They're just color. They're not filled in. But the Palm Sunday parade was meant to be peopled with people who felt something in their heart. So I'm wondering, this parade that we heard about today, where are you? Where are you on the parade? Are you even there? Do you even care that Jesus is marching towards Jerusalem? Are you a spectator? Are you marching with Jesus? Where are you in this parade? Now, if you're a spectator, maybe you're shouting those great words, Hosanna! We've already heard them this morning. Hosanna! The crowds were on the side shouting Hosanna, like, hooray, go Jesus! Except they weren't. Do you know what Hosanna means? Hosanna, in the text of Matthew and Mark, Luke actually forgot it, but that's okay. It's a Greek word, a transliteration of an Aramaic word based on a Hebrew word. Things in ancient texts get rather complicated, don't they? But wonderful. Which simply means, save us! Save us. The crowds on the side, as Jesus was going towards Jerusalem, seated on a donkey, were shouting, save us, save us. What were they asking to be saved from? What was it? Maybe, literally, given that time 2,000 years ago, they were asking to be saved from the Roman occupation of their land and their city. What else could they have been asking to be saved from? What do you need to be saved from? If you're there on the sidelines as Jesus is making his way to Jerusalem and you shout out, Hosanna, Lord, save me, what do you need saving from? Saving from the burdens you're carrying in your life? Saving from the challenges that you confront every day? Save from your exhaustion from all that you are doing? Maybe saved from apathy? What do you need to be saved from? I think most of us need to be saved almost from ourselves. We need to be saved from ourselves. Because in fact, it is ourselves, our negative thoughts, our fears, which intrude on our ability to truly live fully the way that Jesus calls us to live. And that is with a sense of, to quote our current day prophet, William Barber, a revolutionary love. A love that not only transforms ourselves, but transforms how we look at the world. And does not allow anything that is not a word of healing and grace and peace. So I think most of us need to be saved from ourselves. We need to be saved from not having enough faith. Does anyone here feel they have enough faith? There are days, I'm sure, when we all get up. We're listening to the news. We hear the horrors coming off a week, as we just did, where there has been so much tragedy in the world, when those doubts start to rise.
And we need to shout out, Jesus, save me from so little faith. Because what Jesus showed and what he invited us to do is that no matter what, we can persevere on because our lives are not rooted and grounded in the morals and in the ways of the world. Our lives are rooted and grounded in something larger, in the morals and in the ways that Jesus teaches us. So maybe you're a spectator, but I wonder if maybe you're actually walking with Jesus. You're the one right there in the center with him by the donkey. You're the disciple. How many of you, how many of us this day are ready to walk right with Jesus at his side as he makes this journey to Jerusalem? I think it's easier for us to be spectators. So the question I think that we are that is posed to us today is very simple. Where does God want you to be on Palm Sunday? Where does God want you to be? Where does God need you to be on Palm Sunday? Maybe God needs you to be as a spectator because there are things in your life that need to be saved. There are things in our nation that need to be saved. There are things in our world that need to be saved. But maybe God needs you to be walking right next to Jesus. Right next to Jesus as he makes his way to Jerusalem. Palm Sunday can be a significant turning point in your faith. And it was for one of the great martyrs of the 20th century. Today is April 9th. It is the 72nd anniversary of the martyrdom of Dietrich Bonhoeffer. How many of you are familiar with that name? Many of you are. Dietrich Bonhoeffer was martyred during World War II. He was martyred because he resisted the Nazis. He defended the Jews. He was out there trying to do all he could to overthrow the Nazi regime because he saw the evil that was being perpetuated on his Jewish brothers and sisters, on his LGBT brothers and sisters, on anybody who was considered different. He saw the atrocities. And as a Christian, as a person of faith, he could not stand and watch. But one of his turning points in his life happened on Palm Sunday. It happened on Palm Sunday when he was just 18 years old. On that day when he was just a university student, he had taken a semester in Rome. And he worshiped outside the Vatican. The worship he experienced on that day was so profound that it actually changed his worldview because he came to realize on that day that God was not the God of just the Germans. Nor was God just the God of just the Christians. God was a universal God. And it was on that Palm Sunday when he was 18 that his purpose to confront anything that was against God's love started to be honed. And so it is interesting that on Palm Sunday, in 1945, just several days before he and his fellow prisoners were hung in that camp, his Christian prisoners asked if he would do communion. It was Palm Sunday. They wanted to have something that would connect them to their faith, even in that prison camp. And he said, but I can't, because not all of you here in this group are Christian. And if I were to have a service, it would exclude some people for whom it wouldn't be meaningful, and my faith will not let me do that. Well, a few of the prisoners who were there, who identified as atheist, said, no, that is not right. We need a touch of God as well. And so Bonhoeffer, just a few days before he and his fellow prisoners were martyred, on Palm Sunday, had their concluding communion service when they asked God to be with them. And this was a time when, once again, Bonhoeffer reaffirmed that the God that he served was the God of all people, and none were to be excluded, and that hate, violence, and warfare were not acceptable and were not a part of God's world. Just as Jesus lost his life for those very same thoughts and beliefs and expressions and preaching and prophecy, so too did Dietrich Bonhoeffer lose his life for the very same thing. So if we are being challenged this day to not just be spectators, but to walk by the side of Jesus, can we do it? I don't know. I know for myself, I'd rather just be on the sideline. I'd rather just say, Hosanna, save me and save our nation and save all people. It's much harder to take that walk with Jesus on the journey through Jerusalem. But where is God calling you today, on this Palm Sunday, in your faith? Quinn Caldwell, one of our great preachers and ministers, UCC ministers, wrote a wonderful daily devotional for Palm Sunday. I know some of you have already read it. It was brilliant. And what he said is, Jesus needs you to journey with him. Jesus doesn't just need you on the sideline. Jesus needs you at his side. How can you do this? How about making a piece of art for him? Make a piece of art for Jesus. Feed a hungry person for Jesus. Walk a mile barefoot in solidarity with Jesus. Pray with a broken heart with Jesus. Sing the most beautiful song you know to encourage Jesus. And let Jesus know that he is not alone on this journey through Jerusalem on this Holy Week. I think we can do that. Amen.